Welcome to this lecture series on organizational behavior. This is the third section of the second chapter, which is on perception. I'll quickly summarize what happened in the previous lectures. We defined what is perception, and we also tried to understand why it is important to understand perception as a concept in the organizational context. In other words, how will this understanding of perception will help managers to make better decisions. So perception is giving meaning to sensory stimuli, and it is very subjective in nature. For example, the same stimuli, different people may understand it differently. So the entire chapter is divided into two major sections. One about the technicalities of sensory perception, to the idea of social perception. So in the technicalities of perception, we looked at different steps in perception, and in each of those steps we looked at some of the key theories or key issues in those steps. So selecting a stimulus depends on two major factors, one internal, two external. So we looked at what are the internal factors and what are the external factors. The second step of perception is organizing the selected stimulus. We looked at some of the principles humans use to organize sensory stimulus. These principles are suggested by Gestalt theories. So many of these principles in organizing sensory stimuli is applicable to social perception also. For example, the idea of perceptual constancy, which means we tend to see things as constant. We don't perceive change when it happens over a period of time. So which applies to social perception also. Similarly, the idea of closure, which says we try to fill in the gaps in physical perception, which holds true for social perception also. For example, in workplace, when the information which we receive is partial, we try to fill in those gaps with our own understanding or our own assumptions of what it would be. So when problems happen in the way we use these principles of organizing, it can lead to optical illusions. In the previous section, we looked at social perception. Social perception means perception in a social context or perception using social information. So there are a lot of theories and a lot of concepts related to social perception. But we are going to look at only two major areas. One, how do we perceive others, or how do we understand others? Two, how do we understand our own behavior, or how do we attribute cause to our behavior and others' behavior? So I'll repeat. Social perception, the first element which we are trying to see is how do we understand ourselves and others, or how do we make sense out of others and ours, our behavior. Second, when we try to understand behavior, both our behavior and others' behavior, how do we attribute the cause, or what cause do we attribute? So when we try to understand ourselves and others, we try to understand the identity, or who are they, or who am I. So if you remember in the previous lecture, I asked you to do an exercise where I asked you to write 5 sentences starting with I am. So the idea here is to see what constitutes your identity. How do you identify yourself? So in identity, both our own identity and judging others' identity, we use two elements. One, personal identity, and social identity. Personal identity is personal characteristics, using personal characteristics. Social identity is trying to understand someone by understanding their social group or the group in which they belong to. So social identity theory says we try to establish identity, or we try to judge somebody's identity, or we try to perceive others' identity and even our own identity through characteristics which are related to our own self and also to the social group which we belong to or somebody else belongs to. Okay, so this is where we stopped. And one important issue which can happen, or problem which can happen because of trying to establish or try to understand someone based on the social group, is stereotyping, social stereotyping. So we will also look at stereotyping in detail in this particular lecture. If you remember in the previous class, I asked you to look at internet about this term attribution of causality. So attribution of causality is, like I said earlier, when we try to understand others' behavior, we try to attribute the causes of those behavior. For example, if somebody looks very angry, okay, you perceive someone to be a very angry person. First thing we'll do is, why this person is angry? Because of this person is by nature a very irritable, angry person, or because of external reasons. Okay, so so this holds true for attributing cause to our own behavior and also others' behavior. According to Kelly's theory, we use three criteria to check whether some behavior is attributed to internal cause or external cause. So these three elements, or these three criteria, are consensus, consistency, and distinctiveness. So consensus means whether many people agree to it, or whether many people feel the same. Consistency means whether this happens always or consistently. Distinctiveness means whether this particular behavior has happened in one situation or in different situations. So I'll give an example. Let's say in your office, you joined a particular workplace newly, and your supervisor, you feel, is like always irritated at you. Okay, so he or she is showing lot of anger and dissatisfaction towards you. You're not sure whether it is because of and you feel this person is an irritable person. Okay, your perception is this person is an irritable person. So you want to know whether your perception or your understanding that this boss is irritable, is it really true or it is just an assumption. Okay, if it is true, means it is an external reason, which is the boss by himself or herself is a bad person or a irritable person. If it is internal, then it means you are imagining or you are assuming that your boss is an irritable person without any real or external reason. Okay, so consensus, everybody feels, over a period of time you talk to others in your workplace, everybody feels that this person is in fact irritable. Okay, so then it means the boss is really irritable, which is external reason. So your assumptions are not just internal, there's a true reason which is external. And then consistency, which means you consistently feel or have perceived this person to be irritable. Okay, in many situations you have felt this person is irritable, so there are more chances that it is true, which is external reason. Distinctiveness means whether you perceive only this person as irritable or many people as irritable. Okay, if you feel all of them in your office is irritable, then it means probably you are imagining, Okay, if you feel only this person is irritable, distinctively this person is irritable, there are more chances that your boss is irritable, which is external reason. So let's look at the combinations. Okay, usually we use combinations of these three criteria to see whether a reason is internal or external. Okay. Okay, so low consensus, very few people feel or nobody feels the boss is irritable. Okay, and low distinctiveness, you think many people in your office are irritable. High consistency, you have been feeling like this many a times. Okay, then it means it's your problem. If you think everybody in the office is irritable, it means maybe your perception or the reason behind it is the way you look at it is not correct. Okay, vis-a-vis high consensus, everybody thinks this boss is irritable, and distinctiveness is high, which means only this person you feel irritable. Distinctiveness means uniqueness. Uniquely you feel only this person is irritable. High consistency, always you consider this person, boss, to be irritable. That means maybe it is external, which means the stimulus, the boss himself or herself is irritable. Okay. Third, high consensus, many people feel, but not all of them, I mean low distinctiveness, all of them are irritable, and low consistency, sometimes you feel irritable, you feel your boss is irritable, sometimes you feel the boss is good. Then it means circumstances, maybe there is something in the situation which triggers this kind of behavior in your boss or your assumptions. Okay, I hope you understood Kelly's attribution theory. So the basic idea here is we use three criteria, whether many people feel the same or only I feel like this in all situations or only in certain situations. The other person, or you know, I see only few people doing it, which is distinctively I feel, uniquely I feel only this person is like that, or I feel many people are like this or many situations are like this, which is low distinctiveness. So based on these three combinations, we decide whether something is because of internal reasons or external reasons. One important implication of social perception in workplace, or one reason why we should understand social perception in workplaces, the negative impact of social perception, or the perceptual biases which can happen in social context because of social perception. There are many biases. Biases means unbalanced things or one-sided things. So some of the social biases studied in social psychology context, which can be used in organizational behavior context, I have listed few of them. The first one is fundamental attribution error, which means the same Kelly's attribution theory. So if you know, when we try to judge others' behavior, most of the times we tend to attribute it to internal cause, which means if somebody behaves in a certain way, we assume that it is because you know, because they choose to do it. Okay, because it is their own limitation or their own cause, and we largely ignore external factors. Let's say if somebody has failed, okay, somebody didn't perform well, so we attribute it to incapability. We say that this person is incapable, which is internal factors, and we largely ignore external factors. Maybe he or she didn't get enough resources or support from others, so we don't actually see it. This is usually in the case of others, but in our own case, we tend to, if we fail, we tend to attribute it to external reasons. We won't say that, you know, I am incapable. We say, we give a lot of reasons. While on the same time, when others fail, we attribute it to incapability, which is an internal cause. Okay. The second important perceptual bias, which is very common in organizational context, is halo effect. So what is a halo? Have you heard of this term halo? Halo means that, you know, that light kind of a thing, ring which you see in photographs of great leaders or, you know, deities and things like that, or philosophers and things like that. So halo, so what does it signify? Halo signifies worshipping, or, you know, halo worship, hero worshipping kind of a thing, which means we tend to, based on certain impressions we have about someone, we tend to generalize everything under that impression. For example, if somebody, if your teacher is like, you like your teacher, he or she is your role model, you think you cannot get a better teacher than this, okay? And you can never feel that your teacher can falter, okay? Or your parent, you know, you think your parent is the best parent you can get, or anybody can get. You will not see their shortcomings. You will see them as, you know, perfect individuals. So that is what is halo effect. So based on certain qualities which we see in people, good qualities, we tend to neglect some of the other negative aspects of these people. Okay, this is halo effect. In workplace context, it is very important, because you know, we tend to see certain good qualities in people and try to give them good performance evaluation. So this person might be a honest person, you know, is a very committed person, can be a very humble person and things like that. But doesn't mean that his or her performance is good. But what happens is, based on these qualities, we try to overrate performance in terms of actual work performance. So this can lead to impression management techniques, which means people try to impress others through these qualities and try to get extra, you know, points for what they are doing. Okay, so this is what we call impression management technique. Halo, there's also team halo effect, which means teams usually, what they do is, especially if the teams are supposed to be very good teams, you attribute success to them, and if they fail, you attribute it to external reasons. Okay. For example, let's say you like your cricket team a lot, you know, CSK, Chennai Super Kings. You like them like too much. They are your favorite cricket team. And, you know, whenever they succeed, you think they played well. But when they fail, you tell them the umpiring is not good. Okay. So this is what is team halo effect. Similar to me effect is, in workplace context or even in social context, when we perceive others to be similar to us, we tend to look at them in a positive light. Okay. One example is, in fact, I told you this earlier example, you know, if you are standing in a queue and two people break the queue, one person is, one person speaks the language, your mother tongue, other person is a different, you know, regional background. You tend to attribute the person who's from your own language background as probably because there's a true reason, but the other person as willingly breaking the queue. Okay, so in fact, many research show that when we feel the other person is similar to you, similar to us, we tend to trust them easily. Okay, let's say you're going in a train journey, okay, long train journey, and the one who's sitting next to you is speaking your same language or studied in the same college as you. We tend to talk to them more, you know, tend to share our own personal experiences more than to people who are not similar to us. Okay, so again, this can be a serious bias, because many times these similarities are superficial similarities. So we think this person is similar because the similarities are very obvious, but these obvious similarities may not be true similarity. For example, let's say first day in your work, we will try to talk to people who talk the same language or maybe same gender. So we think people like this are trustworthy, may not necessarily. Okay, so we don't explore friendship with other social groups. So this can be a serious flaw, and this can lead to in-group out-group bias. In fact, in one of those examples I gave, how our own group we perceive them to be better than others. Okay, selective perception means when we look at or when we receive many information, we choose only certain information and ignore others. Okay, unconsciously. In fact, this is a very basic idea of perception, isn't it? Like, we get a lot of information in our day-to-day life, but we don't select all the information. We select only fewer information to make decisions. But sometimes what can happen is the information which we have not selected or the information which we have ignored can be a very important information, but we think this information may not be useful. Okay, so this is selective perception bias. First impression error means based on our experiences in the first encounter, we make certain judgment and we tend to hold this judgment for a longer period of time. For example, you know, you are in your workplace, your first experience with your boss is not very positive, it's not very pleasant. So you tend to look at the consecutive behavior of the boss in the same light. Okay, so that leads to closed attitude towards others. It can be positive also. You know, in the interview, somebody tries to impress with the way they greet, the way they, you know, conduct themselves, and we assume that the person might be highly capable. You know, we use that first impression to judge consecutive behavior. So this is one example of halo effect. You know, Obama been given Nobel Prize because of, you know, certain initial things Obama did. Okay, many people criticize that this is like hero worshipping. So which is true for many leaders, world leaders. Okay. So why perception is a powerful powerful thing in real life or in our day-to-day life? I'll give you two examples, you know, which both fall under this idea called self-fulfilling prophecy. Self-fulfilling prophecy means when we start perceiving about some person in a certain way, there are more chances that it will become true. So I said perception is just subjective. You think this is what it is, but it may not be real. Okay, but self-fulfilling prophecy says when you start looking at things in a certain way, there are more chances that it will become real. Okay, especially in terms of people. So self-fulfilling prophecy says when you try to or when you perceive someone as good or bad, over a period of time those people become or fulfill your expectation. Okay, how does it happen? I'll give an example. You know, a class teacher. Okay, so a class teacher believes that backbenchers are notorious students and people who sit in the front are very studious students. Should backbenchers become notorious students? In many cases they become notorious students. Probably they are sitting at the back because some of them are tall and they were sent to the back row. But being tall doesn't mean that you should become notorious. But many a times it happens. Why? Because teacher expects certain notorious behavior from those backbench students, and unknowingly or knowingly teacher exhibits those kind of behaviors or exhibits those expectations, which the students take it as a cue and fulfill that expectation. So the example is, let's say two people in your class talking, two students in the class talking. So if these two students are in the front row, you will think these students are discussing about the class. They have some doubt. So you will ask them, do you have any doubt? Should I clarify you? So you try to be, as a teacher, you tend to be nice towards them. At the same time, two students are talking at the back row. You will consider that, you know, or the reason you will give us, they are not listening to the class. You shout at them. You tell them, you get out of my class. Okay? Or why are you doing it? You're always doing it. Things like that. So what will happen because of that? These students who are sitting in the front will think, oh, teacher have high expectation towards me. I should be good. Students at the back, whatever we do, this teacher is not going to, you know, treat us fairly. So let us be like this. You know, let us be bad students. So this is what is Pygmalion effect. So Pygmalion effect means our thought process shaping others' behavior. Gollum effect is similar to Pygmalion effect, which is when we set low standards to individuals or subordinates, those standards become benchmark for employees. Okay, when you think employees are not going to work and you set them low standards, they also you know, become low performers. Instead, you set high standards. When you give goals to, or when you set goals to your subordinates, you set higher goals, they will perform better. Okay, it holds true for our own self also. When you set goals for yourself, don't set lower goal. When you set lower goals, you tend to perform even lower than that. If you set higher goals, it gives you confidence and you perform better. So this is what is Gollum effect. So perception is not just a subjective thing. It is also a very powerful thing, because based on our perception, people fulfill those expectations. And many a times, knowingly, unknowingly, we communicate our expectations or perception to others, and that becomes the benchmark for others, and they will start behaving in the same way, or they will fulfill our expectation. Okay, so I'll stop here. So what we saw is a quick summary of what we saw. Today we looked at the attribution process. How do we attribute the cause to our own behavior and to others' behavior? Broadly, we classify those attribution into internal and external causes, as either internal cause or external cause. We use three criteria: consensus, consistency, and distinctiveness. Based on the combination, we judge a certain behavior to be attributed to internal cause or external cause. We also looked at some of the biases which can happen in social context, and many a times these biases are inherent part of the way we perceive. We also looked at, even though perception is being subjective, it can really affect others, or it can become real. So we looked at Pygmalion effect and Gollum effect. I'll stop here. As an exercise for the next class, I would like you to look at this word, job stereotype, or in other words, how does stereotypes play an important role in jobs or in workplace? So stereotypes are usually seen as a social phenomena, but I want you to look at or think about stereotype as a workplace phenomena. Why in workplace, or in what ways in workplace stereotypes influence work behavior? Okay.